Today, I'm very pleased to introduce Jean-Luc Bouget. He's here from Paris. He's currently a senior researcher at the Institute of Space Astrophysics in Paris. He got his PhD at Paris University and spent some time in the U.S., including the Miller Professorship, I think, at Berkeley. Frank Miller Fellow at Berkeley.
Sure.
But received a number of prizes, including most recently the Shaw Prize in 2018 and the Brewer Prize in 2018 for the work on the White Silo. I ran into Jean-Luc first, I think slightly before you became PI of the HFI, but for me, you stood out in my mind the next year when you told us that there was a CIB that you had detected with our instrument. And that was a big surprise. So the CIB was first detected with the FIRAS, but not from the FIRAS team. Jean-Luc and a team of people that analyzed our data and found it. And then actually we overlapped a little bit with interest in making further measurements in CIB, including potentially MSI. All of those problems are now long under the bridge. So going on from there, so he's now was the PI of the HFI instrument. And to me, the thing that is most interesting is that he has spent a great deal of time working hard on the low L anisotropy and the low L polarization, which is problematic in the Planck satellite. And you may remember initially there was a 1.5%, 2% difference in the calibration between the calibration, the WMAP experiment I was working on, and Planck, and the question of where that came from was a mystery for almost a year. And Jean-Luc worked very hard on that issue and finally came out with the answer. And so this was when I realized, okay, this guy's working on stuff that matters. These are real problems. And so he's continued making measurements or making analysis of the low L CMB, including now the polarization. And I think he's going to tell us some of the things that come of that analysis. And recently we heard actually from Craig about some of the ideas that might be interesting about the low L CMB anomalies. And I'm hoping that Joan was going to tell us the answer to those things as well. Anyway, Joan, thank you.
Thank you, Adam. Okay, it's a pleasure to be here. And not coming completely to the end of Planck work, although Planck collaboration is going to end in the middle of this year with the last distribution of papers and maps and so on. And I'm going to tell you mostly the work I've been involved in too, which is, as was mentioned just a minute ago, on systematic effects and instrumental effects, especially on the very large scale and polarization large scale. And so I will mention, of course, the results and a bit of results in cosmological parameters and stuff. It would not be my topic today, and it's not the part I've been mostly. So let's just to set the stage about the various experiments on the anisotropy. It started, as you all know, with the DMR with COBE in 1992, and that first discovery or measurement of the acoustic peaks were done in balloon experiments. Satellites which did more accurate measurements were the WMAP and then Planck, which is the third generation. For further it, the so-called Red Book for Planck was a prediction we did in 1995, basically just before being selected, the WMAP was selected at about the same time. And what we were predicting bit later, in 2005, was that we would basically be able to measure several acoustic peaks with pretty good signal generation like that. And we could see basically by eyes that we finally got there. That's a residual compared to this model. So, with 5 years of analysis, we succeeded to get where we wanted to go. And just a bit of instrumentation and so on. The Planck satellite here, especially the high frequency instrument, which has parameters cooled at 100 millikelvin, at three stages of cooling. It was a passive cooling behind this three shield and the solar panel here, which was typically at 35K, 30K. But after, there was an 18K stage with a sorption cooler with hydrogen, then the mechanical cooler helium at 4K, and then 1.6K and 100 mK. So basically, the Planck satellite and the Planck payload, all mixed up, were really a gas factory and a very complicated thermal system. And so it worked really perfectly, and that has been a good part of our work in my work. And so the recent history now of the Planck high frequency maps, so Planck 2018 results, which is the third major release. There was one in 2015, one in 2013, one in 2015. This one, which was called in some of our documents in 2016. So now most of the papers have been put on the archive, and a number of results I will show you is taken from that. Obviously, we froze the maps for the cosmology people to do the science, cosmological science, with that 2 years ago. And so we didn't stay idle for these 2 years. And so we developed a second stage of refinement on the maps. And we just posted that on the archive just last week. And so I will show you that, because that's in terms of large scale polarization and the determination of the ionization of depths, that are interesting. So this is on archive. This is not yet, Luca Pagano is the author on this paper. We think we will probably put that out, but I will give you a preliminary view on that. It's called reionization optical depth determination with a 10% accuracy. And for us, who have been fighting with the early days of Planck and so on, figuring out, having trouble to figure out what really was the value of the parameter, that changed quite a bit over time, is for us an achievement that we were waiting for. Okay. Now, let's go to the improvement on the systematic effects. We had systematic effects which were related to the analog digital converter in behind our detectors, which were non-linearities of these things, which are well known, were not measured well enough. And so we basically had to re-extract from the data. So that was something that was a mistake on our part, not measuring it well enough, because that's for the low frequencies and for the CMB frequencies. Now, bolometer time transfer function is something which was, for the reason I was just before in this very complicated thermal machine, we could expect effectively to have difficulties to pin down very properly the parameter transfer function. Parameters in Planck has a main time constant of milliseconds, and we were saying that we had a very long time constant of 1 to 2 seconds. And finally, now, we found out that there is also still even longer time. So Planck was spinning 1 minute, so it could be basically affecting our data at a very long, very large scale. And especially the dipole on which I will talk quite a lot, these things were measured on that. The other part we refined very much in the last years is the intensity to polarization leakages. Parameters of Planck, we have different detectors to detect two polarization, and so you have to make to combine several parameters to measure the polarization. And so, for example, any calibration mismatch between detectors for the polarization would induce leakage of intensity to polarization. When you look at the foregrounds, you calibrate your detectors on the CMB and the various spectral energy distribution, which is different, of course, on the foreground. If you don't know well enough, this difference could do also, in fact, did intensity to polarization. And also the polarization efficiency is something which was difficult to measure and for which we fought quite well. What we did is we have been able now to put in what we call end-to-end simulation, to put all the known systematic effects in here, and so we could basically generate 500 realization of the data and reanalyze them and really try to figure out when we have null test, saying there is something wrong somewhere, to check that we really understood where it was coming from. So that was very important. Let me talk about dipole. In satellite like back at the L2 point, you have the rotation of the satellite following the Earth at 30 kilometers per second on its orbit. And that's that's the primary calibration. And with the temperature of the CMB measured very well by the COBE FIRE experiment, we have an absolute calibration. Now, of course, we need to figure out how well this is reflected after the map making. And furthermore, there is another dipole, which is the one, the motion of the solar system, which is typically 3 miles kilometers per second, which is 10 times larger signal. And so we have huge signal to noise on that. This was measured, so that's the amplitude of this solar system dipole and the direction of it. The W map measured, in fact, that very well over the direction. The best measurement now is really very, very close to that. They had a number which was smaller than the best measurement now, but the error bar were really accounting for this difference. So that was the satellites converged and was no tension per se in this measurement, but adding a measurement with this quality with one less than 1 micro K on the amplitude of more than 3 stars. And this accuracy on the direction is very, very useful. It's a tool which I will tell you what we could do with that. If we do ratio of frequencies, removing the CMB and removing the synchrotron and the low frequency foreground, we can basically look at ratio of frequencies, and we do see basically we cannot say that, but it's all with respect to the 857, which is the highest frequency, and you could see basically the same pattern at all these ratios all the way down to the gigahertz, and so that shows that basically there is a large gradient, but this large gradient measured on that needs to have a monopole that you fix, because the monopole is not detected by Planck, so it makes only differential measurements. And so you could induce, if you don't do the right normalization of this monopole, you could induce a gradient in latitude. What we did is to say, we measure the dipole very well, it's a differential measurement, and we should see all the frequencies should be the same dipole. And so, in this exercise of really having the measurement of the dipole at all frequencies and changing the convergence, we were forced to, we had the determination of the gradient of the dust spectral energy distribution, and basically you find the same, which means that it comforted the fact that we did a good determination of the zero level, which was not so easy to prove, and that basically that we understand very well this dipole, and so we could use it. Just to convince you that we know it very well, for the direction, for example, you could subtract the CMB anisotropy, because you have to do that. And that's a very simple square triangle and so on. And you should also change the F-sky so that tell you if it's stable that the foreground subtraction is not at stake, and you use all the frequencies. And you could see that all these symbols, these big ones here, are on one of the component separation method, which was a very simple one, but which gave good result, but which is slightly off with respect to all the other ones. But all the other ones are giving you a direction which is within less than an arcmin. And for that, you got also, we got basically the same amplitude as we had, and we had not used the amplitude as a minimization factor. So that was basically the proof we were expecting that we had done the work properly. At 545, which is very high frequency for CMB, the CMB is very far down in the exponential, the 545 gigahertz is way down. Exponential cutoff of the Planck distribution, and that was not work. That was not working with. It was a good accuracy for 545. The last thing we got was that. So we refined that, and basically, even the 545 is within one micro K for that. So that's going to be. I think for the CMB, it's going to stay a tool which will allow to test and consistency of many things we are doing. You could, for example, take this dipole and you remove your model of the polarization for a single detector, and you do a map of the CMB, and you measure the dipole. And then you can intercompare your various things. So you could see here, so this 0.002, this 0.02%, so that's in unit of 10 minus 4. And you can see basically that we are, so the RMS is here 5, 10 minus 6, the RMS at 143 is 8 in minus 6, is 2 to the minus 5, and even at 353, it's 2 to the minus 4. So if I had been told when I was starting doing balloon experiments at the same time Steve was doing so, that I would do photometry at 10 minus 5 with photometers, not a balloon. So, and then you can look at the acoustic piece and compare also the measurement on the three acoustic piece, and you can basically do that when you get to 545. You can do that also. You see the acoustic piece, and basically you are even at a few percent accuracy. So that tells you also that the transfer function between the dipole and multipole up to close of the third peak is very good. So that's you can build upper limits for this transfer function, and you can see basically that from the dipole to 700, it's for the CMB channels. Here, for example, you can see that it's below 10 minutes, so 2 to 10 minutes. Okay. Just a quick comparison between null test 2015 and 2018. And you could see basically that when you do odd even surveys, so we had 5 surveys, and every 6 months, you scan the sky basically on the same rings in the opposite direction as 6 months before. And so that's very sensitive to time transfer function, force silos. So that's something which is very difficult to test. And so you test with that. And you could see basically in polarization that you had, so all these are minus, plus or minus 2 micro K. And you could see that in 2015, we were still at that level. In the 2018 release, you don't even see the galactic plane in the residual. So that's, I find that quite amazing. So that shows that we pin down very well the very long time constant and the very far silo. Let's go to the foreground bandpass mismatch. That's a difficult thing. We had measured for transport spectrometer the spectral transmission for all our detectors, and we could compute basically what is the response of the different detectors to the dust signal or CO line and so on, which are foreground. But you cannot, it was very difficult to measure that with the accuracy that we need. That's just limited by the ability, for example, on polarization of controlling the outside. And what we did, in this SRAL new map making in 2018 and very recently, we extracted, in fact, those from the sky. So you intercompare detector per detector what you are getting on the same pixel, and you measure basically this difference of response. And so that was absolutely key in removing also this the system. Furthermore, in this machine, when you have the different response of detectors, you have to know what is the map on the sky. So we introduced basically in these loops the map of the foreground from the 2015 prints, which are good but not perfect, of course. And what we demonstrated here is that we degraded this 2015 foreground maps, and we run our map making, and then we take this frequency maps and we do a component separation, and we introduce whatever we found in this component separation, and we check that it converges with the best one we had before. And in fact, it just takes three iterations, basically, to come back to the best. So we can extract the foreground from the map making. So what we are doing now is to integrate, in fact, the map making and the component separation, and that's going to be probably in the CMB work, something which several teams are to tell us that they agree with this, that we should go into the thing. Just when I told you about solving the dust, for example, bandpass distribution, in simulation, you take the bandpass and you try to re-extract that from the sky, and so you can see the accuracy that we do. And the same thing for the CO. There is an interesting point in those are just the residuals at different frequencies, and you can see here, for example, for the dust, that in EE or BB, you find basically what we know is the dust power spectrum, which is basically a steep power spectrum as a power. That's on half of the sky and for the high altitude sky. The CO is here, so 100 gigahertz, 217, there is no CO line in the 143. 353, so it's a transition 120 to 1. And you can see that this distribution, the power spectrum doesn't look at all like the dust one. But we all know when we have worked on the interstellar medium physics in the 70s and the 80s that in the molecular clouds, the CO is a very good tracer, as the dust is a very good tracer of matter. So what's going on at high altitude? Well, people who work on the interstellar turbulence will tell you that the dissipation in turbulence is intermittent, because that's what has been shown by simulation and by measurement in laboratories. And in the very diffuse medium, the CO can be generated in the region of dissipation, where there is too much UV for it to stay. And so that's probably transient CO related to the associated with the intermittency of the turbulence. And so there is two modes of CO. There is probably two modes of CO generation, one driven by opacity and the other one is driven by the, and so if this is right, and we are trying to test that better, that the CO and other lines in this subchemistry from the dissipation of turbulence will not have a distribution associated with the other, with the turbulence. Okay, I will skip that. We used two Amherst regular telescope maps from Paul Goldsmith in 12 CO and 13 CO, extracted the coefficient for the 13 CO that we've never been able to extract before, built a map of the old sky, and look in this map old sky for 13 CO and 12 CO in the region for which the region we used to get the coefficient. And you can see basically that we got separation of the CO and the semi-isotopes very well. And so we are now in the process of doing this for the three lines, the 1.2.0, 2.2.1, 3.2.2, and the two isotopes. And we get all sky maps, which have never been obtained yet by the radio astronomer, because it would take a very long time. We skip that. It's showing basically that the angles and the polarization efficiencies have been well measured on the ground. We don't need to change them. There is no systematic effects on the simulation. This is distribution. And the red lines are for different frequencies. The difference, which is typically 0.5 degrees, we were measuring them with an uncertainty of 1 degree. So it's dispersion is even smaller than that. So that's pretty good. We also were afraid the blue line were the previous strong one. And we could find a dispersion and polarization efficiency, which was not compatible with the error. Now, with a refined with a refined measurements, the red one are completely compatible with the error. So basically, in 2015, when you do NERC test, and we did, you know, half mission, different detector sets, cutting each the ring, stable pointings of Planck in two and so on, you could see basically the residuals, which were rising pretty steeply at low multiple. And so that's why we were very careful about not using not trusting the polarization data at the low multiple. So in 2015, for example, we did only high multiple, which were for which the systematics were basically below the white noise. But we did not use them for the low. Thus, we could not measure the realization parameter, which is peaking basically, which is here. So when we summarize the systematics, in fact, you have the noise here, you have the emos that you are trying to detect, especially this bump, which is at very large scale, which is the realization and the place to measure the realization of optical depths is here. And you can see basically that all the systematics at one point are very low, except for the one for the ADC, the analog digital converters, which are of the order of the noise, where of the order of the noise in 2018. Measuring tau is now clarifying that measurement, and what I'm going to show you here is this end-to-end simulation for the power spectra of the emos, and you could see basically that if you do auto spectra, you get that for the 143, for example, blue and yellow, which is already quite below the initial bump, as we call it, here. If you do cross spectra, you could see the scale is not the same. Huh? You put 10 minus 4, and here it's 10 minus 3. So you could see that the cross spectra are even very significantly lower. And so that means that ADC nonlinearity are not correlated between the low frequency, and so the cross spectra, in fact, are now a factor of 30 below this. And so that's basically what allows us to measure tau with a much better accuracy than what we did before. So this is a spectrum. In the Planck 2018 release, in blue, and in this paper that I was quoting, which is the one we put in the archive just last week. And you could see here, for example, that the green error bars are here, for example, typically more than a factor of two lower, that's on the purple pole. You could see here that it's still very significantly lower also. You could also look at the noise in the multipole with no cosmic variance, so that the green bar, and the cosmic variance, which is the blue. And you could see basically that Togo is dominated by the cosmic variance, basically up to multiples. So basically, finally, we are reaching, not completely, but getting close to be limited by the cosmic variance. So we are not at the end, but pretty close to the end of what we can do at this time. So this results are preliminary. That's the paper we are going to put on the archive in a couple of weeks. But it's interesting to see, first of all, that the value of tau that we had measured in 2016, which was 0.055, is basically exactly the same. And 2018, is the same. The error bar here is much smaller than with the other one. And so you can change the sky cut here from 20 to 60%. You can also use the minimum L, which could if we had systematics rising at the well, you could see a trend and we don't. And you could also look at what happens when you this peak is concentrated on a small number of multiples. And you can see basically that when you take out one by one, you could see that basically it doesn't change except for the one for which the shift is 0.7 sigma or something like that, which is equal to 5. All the other ones are basically in the chain. So I think we finally got this parameter. And that's a cosmological parameter, which was the least well measured up to now. So just a bit of what can we extract from this realization parameter? In this paper, Lian and Boucher showed that for the number of the 2018 release, for example, you could constrain the contribution to the optical depth in the range of redshift 15 to 30. And why is this interesting? First of all, we know that the universe is almost fully ionized at 20 to 6, which gives a tau of 0.04 something. And we have the total is 0.055. So it's pretty close. And so the indication is that there is not much ionization at high redshift. And in this way, which is the range of redshift where people expected to have the population shrink in pre-galactic stellar population, put this contribution. Now, with the new number we have, that will go down, and we have not inserted that, but it seems that what I find for myself an interesting problem is why in the history of the development of the structure, the structure which are collapsing on shift of, in this range, which is typically 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 8 solar masses, would not give a lot of beauty and realization. And when this number get lower, which it will when we use the last number for the tower, I think it could it will give a similar constraint with the behavior of this first collapsing objects with this budget. Okay. That's just an image of the 2018 maps, which are now accessible in intensity and in polarization. The cosmology can be done with the intensity, temperature, and the acoustic peaks, as is well known. And it can be done with the polarization. And you can compare what you get from the polarization and from density. And that I'm not going to discuss that very long, but just basically the two models, the lambda CDM model from the intensity or from the polarization, are within typically 0.2, 0.3 sigma of each other. So coherence, which is quite remarkable. We also know that there is a degeneracy if we use only the acoustic peaks to do the model. But you can remove this degeneracy by looking at the lensing. And the lensing signal, as you can measure it by four-point correlation function, you can plot as a multiple, as a distance of the two pairs, the prediction of the model, and the measurement. And bingo on the model. I'll come back to that after, because there is a problem with the lensing, which is an interesting one, knowing that the lensing measured like that is exactly the same as the one predicted by the model. I will jump on these things and come to the evolution of the parameters. The evolution of the parameter from was really the low value of tau, which was low, but not very low. It was 0.08, it was still significantly over 0.055. And in 2016, the even lower value, which is found with the large scale polarization of the HFI, as I told you, is what is driving, in fact, that's the main change in the cosmological part. Most parameters didn't change, but at least a few changed. Maxima and the history of polarization change. What are the parameters? So I'm not going to discuss all the parameters, the cosmological parameters, but there's an interesting, this the tau, which is the one we publish here, and as you could see, it's 0.54, and you could see basically it's 0.455 in the new unpublished this has a bearing on the upper limits we can place from the CNB on the sum of the mass of neutrinos. And so that has been one of the parameters which change constraint is stronger. And if we would be fully, fully limited by the cosmic variance, that could go down by even the n effective, which is the effective number of neutrinos or species, relativistic species, which is also constrained for the same reason. It's really very, very close to the expected value for neutrinos and no other species. In the paper which summarize cosmology from Planck, you would see basically the trend from PW map to W map 1 year until 9 years, Planck 2013, Planck 20. And what you can see is that for some parameters there is a trend, but there is essentially coherence, but reduction of the error bars, which is quite spectacular. So an example of that is that, for example, if you look, you plot the matter fraction and the curvature, which means the deviation from the lambda CDM model, which is the model for which basically we are at the critical density of energy density. You could see basically that when you take only these the acoustic peaks in temperature and in polarization, including the low L, as I discussed, you have basically in this diagram, if you don't force the lambda CDM model, where the curvature is zero, you have this degeneracy which remains. The lensing gives you error bars, which are our contours, which are here, and if you add the PAO, you converge basically bingo on the lambda CDM model. So there is really something, when we add more and more things, we converge towards the lambda CDM. So that's why all cosmologists think it's a pretty good value. Where are the problems? Well, I'll finish on the tensions. There is a tension usage, which is well known. And you can see here, for example, that the recital, for example, measurement of the supernovae is here, and the contours from Planck are here. When you do contour from Planck and you add other constraints, not going into detail, you could see that you have a very small area contour, and basically, doesn't convert. Same thing with the lensing. Part of the lensing is it's not the lensing problem. This parameter was introduced for the parameter in the parameter determination, saying, well, what is if the lensing value is not the one predicted by the model? And there is something which tells you that basically the high acoustic peaks have not enough contrast, and so you need not enough contrast. So, to get something like that, you need to wash out a bit the eye acoustic piece. And so you need to increase the lensing, which is not doing that for you. But as I showed you, the measurement on the 4-point differential function is it's right. So that's just putting a correction, which is doing what you want, but which is introducing the contradiction with the more direct measurement of the density. It's not the density, but it is still a problem. I will not swear that there is not something in systematic effects, also we have looked for it, that washes the effect. But so the main effect now remaining is H naught. And this one I will not worry that much because it's a small effect at IL, and what we need is to rediscuss that. For example, the tension on with a large scale structure as basically, I will not discuss this plot, but basically the message here is that this tension has gone down. So there is not too many tensions in this model, but there are one or two, presently one, which is quite severe, and we need to see where it will go. Last thing about the inflation models. Inflation models are constrained by the tilt of the spectrum, the primary spectrum that you get, deviation from one, and the tensor to scalar ratio for which we are only at the polynomial. And so, what at this stage, for inflation model, we have just upper limits on the ratio of tensor to the scalar. So inflation models predict that it should be tensor-more, but this is not worrying a bit. So I think basic model for the time being is pretty strong. And well, that's just my last slide to say that to measure R with higher accuracy that we have now, a number of experiments are aiming to, for example, spider do experiment or act could get, if they get to their sensitivity, final sensitivity to the green and the red curve here. What we looked at here is that to figure out if the 353 gigahertz dust channel will be able to clean these data at the right level, and that's the dashed line in dark, almost at the same level. And so the 353 gigahertz data tank probably longer lifetime than the augmented volume of 50, which would be the ground-based experiment, the blue experiment are probably going to be better than that soon. Thank you.
Given that we agree with the 4-point correlation function and understanding of funding, and allow another free craft. So they're not just a degeneracy of a single A and A vowel, but there's also a H. So have you done that kind of fit? Do you allow that grammar? I mean, clearly there's something you don't understand.
Yeah, absolutely. People who've been doing some parameters have been turning around the problem.
But it's absorbed into AL. So.
Yes, which I don't like that because it's an artificial way to avoid the problem, if I may say so. So you're right in saying that we should treat this discrepancy on the contrast of the IL for what they are, not explained, and not treat. If you treat it as an AL, you might miss, in fact, it's not very likely that it's AL because the 4-point correlation function is so well on the curve. It's not quite lensing. Thing is okay. The one we see is the I contrast, but the IL experiment should certainly bring some light on this, on the contrast of the I. IL. And I don't know if it has been done with this.
I was intrigued by your Mocha's module result about two types of articles you asked in Galaxy. But I'm not sure I understood what those types of correspond to physically. So it's one, a low altitude more concentrated in traditional molecular clouds, and the other one is more diffuse. So anything like that, I just was wondering whether you can say a bit more about two different types of CO that you found.
If we look, if I would own in molecular clouds, you could trace some matter like the CO and like the dust. Two isotopes trace dense gas with a rare isotope, but that's one very well understood. Half of the sky, I was showing this plots on the best half of the sky, which is fairly basically diffuse H1. For which UV is destroying the CO. And the fact that it doesn't have the same distribution as the, because the H1 has the power of slope decreasing steeply with L. So difference in the power spectrum point obviously where it's different distribution. Now we are trying to not to lose that power spectrum, which is a global thing that says it's not distributed in the same way, but it doesn't tell you how it's distributed. So we are starting to try to trace the high latitude CO and correlate it with something else. Obviously, you have to be on matter somewhere, but the same distribution. So what I was hinting at, which is two types of CO, one introduced, one driven by the opacity, and the other one driven by the dissipation, which is intermittent and that shift, is one explanation, not necessarily the only one. But if it's true, and if we really converge with something like that, it's going to be very interesting. Because it's the first way, but it's another way to trace intermittency in the interstellar turbulence. And furthermore, for future experiments, you will have to be careful about CO land, but the land of the up chemistry, and not necessarily with the same ratio of CO to other lines, that we have in molecular clouds. So this is potentially a tricky problem for high latitude because we are not going to measure R behind the molecular So this description of CO as an interesting